sympathy to Brian and Amanda Snook and family. Brian's mom, Becky Meredith, passed away this morning. Please continue your prayers for Mike Masters. He remains hospitalized at Bryan West following a stroke. His recovery is going well. Please keep the pastor nominating committee in your prayers. And our thanks to Tim McAllister and Mike Holtz from Snow Road. Are there any more joys or concerns? Okay, on to announcements. There will be no church daycare today. The worship team is scheduled to meet Wednesday evening at 5:30 p.m. And the elders at PNC will meet in the library following worship. Are there any more announcements? Okay. Our theme verse this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 11 through 13. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Then when you call upon me and come pray to me, I will hear you. When you search for me, you will find me, if you seek me with all of your heart. Please rise for our response to call. Arise, shine, for your light has come.
I can only imagine.
promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, though I recognize that I am woefully unqualified to preach to this congregation, if it is your will, please give me the words to deliver the message we want your people to hear today. Open our hearts to hear your word. As we begin this sermon series, please help us learn about mankind's relationship with you and subsequently our own relationship with you. Help us learn about all of the promises you have made to us and fulfilled. Show us how we can grow in our faith and become closer to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Today, we will begin our sermon series, Getting to Know God. Over the next few weeks, we will explore who God is and all that he has done. We will discuss the relationship that mankind has had with God since the beginning of biblical history. Throughout time, God has shown himself to us in many ways. He has spoken directly to us through the prophets. He has come to us in dreams and visions. He has become flesh to walk among us, and he remains with us today through the Holy Spirit. He has kept every promise and prophecy that he has revealed to us. Man, to say the least, has not been so reliable. In fact, at every turn we have broken our covenants with God. Over the coming weeks, we will explore this relationship, how God has given us countless opportunities to mend it, and how we can work to solidify our personal relationship with God today. Now, if you have any questions or comments about anything we discuss in this series, I want you to let me know. For that matter, anything I ever say, I want you to let me know. You can talk to me directly, or you can email or call me. If you don't have my contact information, just call the church office and Val or Deb will provide it to you. I'll either respond to your question directly, or if I feel like it's a question that a lot of people might have, I will wait till the following week of the series and address it with everyone. I'm really excited to go on this journey with you, and I hope you're excited as well. Today, we're going to talk about the very creation of earth and man. Now, much of what we discuss today is information you are likely familiar with already, but just bear with me. You see, in order to understand our relationship with God, we need to start with Genesis. And though we've heard it before, the miracles that God performs in the earliest days of creation are amazing. And his first interactions with us really set the tone for the relationship between God and man through history. And as we move along in the sermon series, we will talk about some lesser known scripture and eventually about the life, ministry, death, and resurrection of our Savior. So while we'll start out with some very familiar scripture that may seem elementary, just hang in there with me because it's going to get interesting. But for now, let's begin, well, at the beginning. The very first line of the Bible. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth. So in our quest to get to know and understand God, let's start there. From nothing, God created everything. So let's put that in perspective. Science teaches us that matter cannot be created or destroyed. If you know your physics history, you will remember that a scientist by the name of Antoine Lavoisier is credited with this discovery. It is known as the law of conservation of mass. It tells us that we cannot create anything, nor can we destroy it. All we can do is change its form. As an example, we can take a pot of water and we can boil it away. And it may seem like that water is gone. But in reality, that water still exists. It just now exists as a gas. Eventually, it will cool and return to water. The same is true in creating matter. We can combine two or more existing elements and create something different. But the original ingredients must already exist in nature. We cannot create them. Now, you probably can't see it, but this is a grain of salt. combine a chlorine molecule and a sodium molecule and create salt. But those molecules must exist in nature before we can combine them. We cannot create anything. We can only use the ingredients the Lord has already created and combined them. God, on the other hand, created the earth, not to mention the rest of the planets, celestial bodies, and everything that exists in the universe, and He created it from nothing. So the first thing we need to know in our quest to get to know God is that He created everything. The heavens and the earth, the sun and the stars, the known and the unknown, it all comes from God. And that alone is worthy of praise. But of course, He didn't stop there. Genesis chapter 1, verses 20 and 21 say, "And God said, let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let the birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. So once God created the universe, He began to create life. And again, I want to pause for a moment and reflect upon that amazing fact. We are still in the first chapter of the first book of the Bible, and God has created countless wonders that we cannot duplicate. Now He's created life. Once again, science can do many amazing things. We can repair hearts, and machines can duplicate the work of many of our vital organs. But regardless of how hard we may try, we cannot spark life. Despite the best efforts of the greatest scientific and medical minds throughout the history of man, we cannot take that which has no life and give it life. God, on the other hand, breathed life into every living creature on the earth. From the microscopic single-cell organism to the largest beast growing in the land, each one created and given life by our sovereign and almighty God. Moving on to Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. "Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being." So from dust that He created, God created man. He created our circulatory, nervous, and respiratory systems. He created our minds and our souls, and every complexity that makes up our being from dust. So now we have the world, we have the plants and the animals, and we have man and eventually woman. The Garden of Eden is paradise, everything is in harmony, and they live happily ever after in the end. Okay, so things go on good for a time, but soon enough, in Genesis chapter 3, now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. The eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made one cloth. There you have it. God had made an arrangement with Adam and Eve. God provided everything they needed, and they were living in paradise. But they failed to obey God. And as we go through this sermon series and examine mankind's relationship with God, this will be a recurring theme. Now, this was the first of many covenants, although the Bible does not use the term covenant in this circumstance. But the first of many agreements that God will make with man. And unfortunately, as was the case with Adam and Eve, mankind often fails to uphold it under the bargain. So now, we have sin. And sin did what sin always does. It creates separation between us and God. And of course, sin is also a slippery slope. So before long, in the very next chapter, in fact, we have our Bible. Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 and 7 teach us, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of humankind was great in the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of their hearts was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made humankind on earth, and it grieved him in his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out from the earth the human beings I have created, people together with animals and creeping things and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the sight of the Lord." Now this scripture demonstrates several facts. First, the inclination of man to commit sin and even violence, to the point that God was sorry he created us. It saddens me when I read that verse. Already, this early on in our relationship with God, we can see that we collectively chose to live in sin rather than obey God. Yet, even in a violent and sinful world, God sees and recognizes his good and faithful followers. Of course, you know that in the coming chapters, God commands Noah to construct an ark to save his family from the flood, which will wipe out the rest of mankind. Noah, who was a good and faithful servant of the Lord, obeys him, thus saving his family and the animals. And what a wonderful testament to Noah's faith as an example to us all. Often, what God expects of us as his followers is contrary to the expectations of society. As Christians, we are called to obey God, and sometimes God will ask of us things that others will not understand. We may be ridiculed or even persecuted as has happened throughout history, but we know that God has a greater plan, and no one knew it too. So, of course, Noah obeys God and builds the ark. He and his family, along with the animals, survive the flood. Now, it's after all of this, when we hear of God's first covenant with man, or at least the first time the word covenant is used. As we discussed earlier, there was an arrangement with Adam and Eve, but the word covenant was not used. Now, as we go through this series, we will learn about a number of covenants. And those covenants really begin to define our relationship with God. And as we progress through the Bible and learn of these agreements, we will see how God continuously offers us ways to live in his kingdom. And each is a demonstration of his patience and his love for us, culminating in a new covenant. We'll get to that later. For now, back to Noah. So the flood is over, and the waters have receded, and Noah and his family exit the ark and immediately begin to build an altar to the Lord. We then read in Genesis 9, 7 through 15, "And you, be fruitful and multiply, abound the earth and multiply it. Then God said to Noah and his sons with him, as for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after me, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animal, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall the flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. God said, this is a sign of the covenant that I make between you and me and every living creature that is with you, for all the future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh." created us and loves us. Initially, he intended for us to live in paradise and walk alongside him. Sadly, we didn't follow one simple rule he had established, and instead we chose sin. We continued to become more and more sinful to the point that God flooded the earth and began again with Noah and his family. He established a covenant with Noah and promised never to flood the earth again. Next week, we will learn about the generations that will follow. We will discuss some of the interesting events that will come to pass leading up to Abraham. Now, Abraham was another faithful servant of the Lord with whom God will establish another covenant. Now, this one comes with some more difficult requirements for man. In the weeks to come, we'll have a much better time together. I hope that you will all be able to join us next week as we explore more about our relationship with the Lord and we continue getting to know God. Please rise and join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. In the third day, to grow into well-watered fruitful trees of life. May you bless our offering.